I think I started just a two-part series of lessons talking about heavenly rewards. And last week we were in 1 Corinthians 3, and we were talking about, as Paul compared to that church at Corinth, a master builder to the Christian who's trying to build his house for the Lord properly and send those rewards on to heaven. There's nothing wrong with having things here, but we want to have things over there. We want to send those rewards. And God gives us specific criteria, specific promises. And last week we talked about God wants us to do the right things for the right reasons in order to accumulate those rewards in heaven. And we want to talk just a little bit more today. The scripture Gail read today was from Matthew chapter 6, verses 19 through 21. And she's reading there talking about, don't lay up for yourselves treasures upon earth, for the moth will get them, or that they might rust. And, it really struck a chord as I was reading that scripture again last night. Because I thought of my dad, and he's doing well, by the way. And my dad's piece of property down in Paris, Tennessee, he had met a man who had a bunch of boats. I mean, this guy must have had 20 or 25 boats. I mean, we're talking the not yacht-type boats, but just the regular fishing-type boats. And he needed a place to store them. I mean, that's got about 80 acres, and behind the barn there, there's a little clearing. And so this guy negotiated with him. And if you know my dad for any number of years, my dad negotiates with someone, he always comes out on the losing end of but this guy ended up putting all these boats on my dad's property behind his barn, and there, year after year after year, they sat. Now finally the guy died. He never did anything with these boats. They just sat there. And nature took its course on every single one of them. Even the fiberglass ones began to rot and stuff like that, because some of them had been there for over 20 years. And these boats that were pristine and new, and slide those babies in the water and do whatever you wanted to do. Nature took its toll. Some of the other ones, the scripture says, they began to rust and they were eaten out. And it ends out they're all at a point in time, my dad finally, when none of the family would come and get the boats after the gentleman passed away, he just called the junk deal and they hauled them away to the junkyard. All that time, they didn't improve. They didn't improve. Kind of, I guess some of us can identify with that today, right? Those that believe in the evolutionary stuff that we keep getting better and better, and my 62-year-old bones and yours, however old they are, will tell you otherwise most of the time, won't they? But I thought of my dad, and I thought of those boats. I just sat right. We don't want to have those kind of rewards that will rot and fade and rust away. We want to have the rewards laid up in heaven where nobody can steal them, nobody can take them away, because our God, which sees in secret, wants to reward us openly for all the good things we've done for Him, with the right heart, with the right attitude, with the right impetus to make a difference for His kingdom. That's what He wants today. Our rewards in heaven are God's promise to us that love Him. He promises us different types of rewards. And I was researching just several other scripture there, as the Apostle Paul had a lot to say about rewards. In the book of Colossians, he says, Colossians 3, 23 and 24, he says, whatever you do, work heartily as unto the Lord and not to men, knowing that from the Lord you will receive the inheritance of your reward. What we're working for in the body of Christ comes from God. And that's what we got to keep in mind. That's what we got to keep our focus on. There was a number of years when I was working in telecommunications and IT technology downtown, where the people that I was working for
people. They were demanding, and they expected too much work. Is it fair to say, Curia, too much work and not enough time to do it in? You get that occasionally? And you've probably been through it too. I know Perry does a similar job than I did for all those years. But they want unreasonable intervals. It's during those times that I would tell myself when I was doing that, I'm doing this unto the Lord. I want to be an example to those that I'm accountable to here. Ultimately, everything to point toward the Lord. And that's what you've got too. You might be in a similar situation. You might have similar circumstances, but we're accountable to God, and He's the one that will reward us ultimately as we are serving the Lord Christ, as Paul says. In 1 Corinthians 15, he says, "My beloved brothers, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that in the Lord your labor is not in vain." Now, if you're like me, anything like me, sometimes I feel that whatever I do just doesn't matter. Ever felt that way? Whatever you do just doesn't matter. Like, I can do this. We used to have a phrase for this at work, at the secular job, no good deed goes unpunished. Sometimes you think, no matter what you do, if you try to be proactive, you try to be sincere, you try to be just do the best you can, that it just doesn't matter. The Apostle Paul was telling the church of Corinth, he says, "You do it unto the Lord, knowing that your labor is not in vain." And that's one of the great things, great excuses, or great circumstances that the devil, our great adversary, will use against us. He will cause us to feel certain ways and think that they're actually true. Because the devil wants you to believe, as I've already said, that what you do doesn't matter. That's what he wants you to think. That's what he wants me to think. Because he just wants us to quit trying. He doesn't want us to serve God. He doesn't want us to try to make a difference. He doesn't want us to try to be an example to these little ones that are up here today. Thank God for a godly grandfather that loves these kids and brings them to church. He doesn't want us to begin. Many of you are the same way. Bring those kids to church. Teach them about God. It's not the act of coming to church, but it's learning that there's a Christ that came on that cross. There's a Christ that paid the penalty for their sins. There's a Christ that we're accountable to. There's a Christ that wants to reward us in everything we do for Him. He loves us today. He wants to make a difference in our lives today. Our rewards in heaven are something He promises to us. We'll be judged though. This is one of the sobering things that hits me hard sometimes. We're going to be judged, I believe, according to God's Word, on the amount of quote-unquote light that we have received in our lives. Everybody, when we like to think, you know, that everybody has an equal opportunity in this world today. But you know, the truth is, not everybody does. Not everybody. If we can go to different parts of the world and they really don't know anything about God or Christ, or the cross, or the empty tomb. There are folks that God calls to go to them, to carry that gospel. And those are folks who give up literally everything in their lives for the blessings of the gospel. God has a reward for them too. So we never know who God will put in our path. There's people that you know that I will never come in contact with. It's your responsibility to share the gospel with them. There's people that I know that you will never come in contact with. There's circles that we all run in that other folks won't enter into those circles of people, friends, family, etc. But it's our responsibility to be a light to those with the gospel that God has given to us. It's our responsibility to reflect His life because He wants to reward us. And that's one of the greatest lies that Satan continues to tell, that God does not care about you. God does not care. He's been doing it since the Garden of Eden. Remember what the servant told thee? She had it straight. She knew that they were not supposed to mess with that one tree. And the serpent says, well, he didn't really say that. She goes, oh, well, what did he say then? We begin to listen to secondary opinions when we should be listening to God. God wants to reward us for the things that we do for Him. The devil wants us to do absolutely nothing for Him. It's one of the things that I'll use the word pride in the proper context. It makes me so proud to be a part of this church, because this church is active. This church loves people. This church reaches out to people. We try to make a difference internally and externally in our community. We do our best to meet the needs of folks in and around us and in those places like the heifer pond and stuff like that. We try to do that. We try to do that. And that's what God wants us to do. The devil says, nah, don't do that. Don't do that. There's no use in doing that. It won't make any difference. It won't make any difference. I don't know. I mean, Mike Beach is going to get on me for this, but I got to throw in a couple of hours, Mike. I was a little discouraged yesterday when my boys were down 7-2. I didn't have much hope, you know. I mean, I wasn't even watching the game. I just kept checking my phone, and I was thinking bad things about the Cincinnati Reds. That's who they were playing. Then I looked at my phone, you know, a couple of times later, you know, between splashes of the paintbrush or something like that, helping my son, and I go, oh, it's 7-4. When you're down so many runs in any kind of game, whether it's baseball or football or soccer or whatever it is, you get down so much to support me, you go, well, there's no use of even trying. We've lost. And I texted at that point my cousin, who is a big-time Cincinnati Reds fan, who just likes to stick it to me unmercifully on occasions, and he's been on a field day here lately. I said, well, it looks like that's a throwback to the big red machine in the 70s when you guys were just beating us up one side with the ballpark and down the other. And he texts back to me. He goes, well, the game's not over yet. I thought, yeah, right. Cubs won 8-7. I told him that he was a prophet. And I didn't need him too much because they're going to play against me. But you know, sometimes we want to give up because we don't see there's hope. If we apply that to a spiritual realm, we've got to keep fighting for what we know is right. We've got to keep doing what we know is right, because God will sort it all out, and He'll make the difference. He'll either make the difference in us or in someone else's heart and life that we're able to touch because we kept trying. We kept trying. Wasn't that one of the most attributable quotes to Winston Churchill back in the World War II era? Never give up. That's got to be our moniker for the cause of Christ. Never give up. Jesus didn't quit on us, so we certainly don't want to quit on Him. But we're going to be judged on the basis of the light that we've received in our lives, and it's our responsibility to tell others that God has opened doors for us. We're told in the book of Matthew, though, that God rewards specific people for specific things. Those that are persecuted for Jesus' sake, we mentioned last week in Matthew 5, they have a reward. Those that are taking advantage of those who are persecuted, many even have sacrificed their lives for the cause of Christ. They've been martyred for that cause. They have the reward. Don't get me wrong, folks. I'm not into suffering. Lord calls me home. I know where I'm going, but I have no hurry to die either. But what a comfort to know that He's in control of that. But a comfort to know that I'm accountable to Him, that you're accountable to Him in every aspect of our life that way. That He's prepared a reward for those that love Him. He even says in Matthew 10:42, if we give a cup of old wine to one of God's saints who is doing something for God, we give them a cup of cold water in His name, then He'll reward and He'll honor that in our lives. So when you think what you're doing doesn't matter, when you think what you're doing is not as important as what someone else is doing, if God has called you to do that thing, as simple as it may be, keep doing it. Keep doing it. Stay faithful to it. Don't give up. Don't quit. Don't get discouraged. We talked about in Bible study just a few weeks ago in Galatians. Don't grow weary in well-doing, because in due season you'll reap. You'll reap the benefits. You'll reap the fruits. If we faint not. Oh, to be that close and to give up and have the victory within your hands, within our grasp. Never realized the truth of what could have been. Sometimes God calls folks to leave family and personal possessions for the cause of the gospel. We're reminded of that rich young ruler that came to Christ looking for salvation. And Jesus could see the desires of his heart. And Jesus told him, he says, I see you and I hear your request. Go sell all that you have. Come and follow me. You can search the Bible from beginning to end, and no one else does Jesus offer that opportunity to sell all that you have and come and follow me. In fact, the disciples, none of them had that great wealth that this man had. Scripture tells us that this gentleman went away sorrowful because he was a very rich man. He didn't want to sell all of that and give that up for the life of following Christ. He wanted salvation, but he wanted it on his terms. You'll accept me, God, the way I am. We don't see that attitude in our society anymore, do we? Pastor says tongue in cheek, right? We're in a world today where people just want God to accept them the way they are. You will accept me, God. I will dictate my terms of coming to heaven to you. It doesn't work that way, folks. He tells us very clearly. He says, I'm the way, I'm the truth, I'm the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. We dictate nothing to God. We accept His forgiveness by His mercy and His grace. You can't earn it. You can't work for it. You can't pay for it. A gift is a gift that's given by Him. Our rewards in heaven are based upon our obedience. Again, as we said last week, no, Pastor's not preaching that we get to heaven by doing things. But because we are created in Christ's work, created in Christ, we are His workmanship, Ephesians chapter 2 tells us. Because we're created in Him, and because we follow Him, and because we're part of His family, we will want to do things for Him, to further His kingdom, to share the faith that He's delivered to us. To share that faith. Our rewards in heaven, we will be called the sons of the Most High. Sometimes it is discouraging when you see others prosper when they don't necessarily seem to be doing the right things or the best things or the good things. But God assures us that if we'll plant, when He tells us to plant, another will come along and water it, and that we will both rejoice in the harvest. You might be the one to someone else's planet, and you might be the one that waters someone else's lines. Great is your reward for doing that. God makes no distinction in that. He just wants us to be faithful. If you'll be faithful to Him this morning, He promises us just some of these rewards that we mentioned. Some of these crowns we said last week. We cast them toward the Lord's feet. That's the big picture. That's the big picture. It's all about Him, much less about us. What John the Baptist said, he said, He must increase, meaning Christ, and I must decrease. We get our priorities right, we get our attitudes right, they'll adjust our hearts. We'll do right with God. We'll store those rewards, those blessings up in heaven where God wants us to. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen.